Hello. The idea of this particular episode of the podcast started, well, as most of them do start, with a discussion we had in private about weird philosophers, and that it would be interesting to find certain philosophers that we would do research on independently, and then we would present them to each other and to you. So enjoy.
And just a disclaimer, this is just touching the surface of the subject, and we have just chosen six philosophers, three pre-Socratic and three modern philosophers, and a lot of things have been rephrased so we can understand and reword it better for our own understanding. So obviously we will link everything down below to make it more easier for people to research into them more if the interest goes further than this episode.
Hopefully. I'll begin.
Mm-hmm.
I chose the pre-Socratic and the Socratic periods.
Mm-hmm.
I chose three guys. And the guy I decided to start on, which, to be fair, in comparison with the other guys, he's kind of mild. I felt like maybe I should have changed it, but my first guy is Pythagoras. And we obviously know Pythagoras because he's one of the most famous mathematicians, and he came up with the method of the sum of the squares of the legs of a right triangle is equal to the square of a hypotenuse.
Hmm.
Did you fall asleep?
No, I was just actually thinking about a PTSD memory where the math teacher would always ask us that fucking question at the beginning of every class.
I will never be able to forget it for as long as I live.
I forgot it.
Oh, really?
I mean, I think I kind of know it in theory, but I don't know. Not in practice,
oh,
really.
Oh, brother. Anyway. Give me a right triangle. I'll find out the hypotenuse. Okay, so he was a mathematician, but he was also a quite important philosopher as well. Because I chose my guys from pre-Socratic and the Socratic eras, it's rather hard to say how much is true. Most, like, for example, in Pythagoras's case, none of his original writings survived.
Mm. So is this just like what other people...
Yes. It's mostly what other people wrote about him, or legends.
Mm-hmm.
And sadly, that's mostly the case with the other guys as well. Okay, so why the hell did I choose Pythagoras? Well, Pythagoras was a cult leader.
Heh.
He was a cult leader.
A cult leader.
A cult leader.
Okay, just making sure I heard that. That's right.
He founded Pythagoreanism.
Mm-hmm. Sounds legit.
Yeah, he named the cult after himself. The Pythagorean practices,
mm-hmm,
and beliefs were not necessarily that unusual, especially in regard to other religions,
so
as we come to know them.
So does that mean that he was actually thinking to make this a religion? Or are you just comparing it because you said compared to other religions?
No, it was a cult. Which he was a leader of a religious cult.
Oh, is this a side?
Where he was the... No, not, it wasn't a side. It was very intertwined with him being a mathematician.
All right. Because if you think of it, in my head it doesn't really make sense, because as a mathematician, you go and have concrete evidence and results, right? But as a religious person is more about belief?
Well, not necessarily, because you have to remember that he was seen as this godlike persona because he was one of the few people that truly understood maths at that time.
Okay, yeah.
And he was able to explain certain things. And you have to put it in perspective because, you know, hearing, even today, hearing someone that gives you certain answers that you wouldn't be able to answer using today's science, and you would see that person as, oh shit, he might be something more than me.
Especially back in a day where not everyone had access to going to school and education in general.
Right.
So what was his actual philosophy? You know what I mean? What was he preaching from a philosophical point of view?
To be part of his cult, you had to love math in the most archaic way I can put it. It was obliged to study. And they had a very different way of thinking about numbers. They didn't think of, like, when you say a number, for example, give me a second because I wrote one example. When you say one, you think of just like the quantity of a thing. I have one grain of rice. But for them, number one was a symbol of unity. Mm. It symbolized God and the universe. It wasn't just a number. It had the ability to change the state of other numbers. Mm-hmm. So if you add one to an even number, it becomes odd.
Yeah.
And vice versa. Mm. And numbers were mostly seen as symbols.
Yeah.
Symbols you would use to explain the world.
Just like math, because math in a way is explaining things through theories.
Right, but it's very interesting to think about the fact that, oh shit, this guy had to start somewhere. Yeah. Like, we learned his theorem in school in, what, 7th, 8th grade? Maybe even earlier than that. And it's just a given now. But he probably studied for years to find that out.
And no one told us he was a cult leader.
Okay, so do you want to get into his practices?
Yeah.
They're not that
as
bad.
As a cultist or as a cult leader or as a mathematician? Or is it just not even distinguished? It's the same thing?
No, it's mostly the same thing. They didn't really had a... they wouldn't make a difference between... Because it was just... You had to be a mathematician to be in his cult, essentially. Yeah. So their beliefs consisted in reincarnation.
Yeah.
Which, honestly, to me was surprising at first. Because I thought it was something more... you know, you usually attribute it to Southeastern beliefs. Mm-hmm. Okay, so they believed in reincarnation, which means that after death, the soul of a man could be reincarnated in any living thing. And the story goes that one day, Pythagoras was walking down the street and he saw some people beating a puppy and he begged them to stop, because the soul of his best friend was reincarnated into the puppy.
Mm-hmm.
He swore that when the puppy screamed in pain, he could actually hear his friend's voice coming out of the puppy. So it was a big no-no.
He was on some strong mushrooms.
Another thing was vegetarianism. Eating an animal was forbidden due to the belief in reincarnation. You wouldn't eat if your grandma would reincarnate in a chicken, you wouldn't eat your grandma. So you weren't allowed to eat animals.
Mm-hmm.
And loving math. We already sort of covered that.
So if you had all of these were like requirements to get in the cult, weren't they?
well, not to get, but to be a part of it. You were obliged to respect
mm-hmm.
these things.
Mm-hmm.
And to study, to dedicate your life to studying math. Numbers.
I mean, cults in general sound like a nightmare, but on top of that, to add math, I feel like that's on another level.
I kind of like it. I think it's interesting, you know, to sort of, because I don't necessarily think it is a cult based in what we understand today, but sometimes we attribute these when you talk about a cult today, you think about all these awful people that abused their members.
Yeah.
Which it is. You sort of have to abuse power, I think, to qualify as a cult.
Cult leader.
Don't quote me on that. But you do need the one person at the top, which this obviously was.
Yeah.
One weird thing that Pythagoras had this obsession with beans for some reason.
As in beans?
Beans, as in fava beans.
As in eating beans?
Right.
Like kidney beans?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
He had a very strange obsession with beans, and they were forbidden from consumption. You weren't allowed to eat beans.
But they're the shit. They're so good.
I agree. The reason was because he believed that the flatulence beans induced after consumption, you would lose the breath of life in the process.
Wow. That's the excuse I'm going to use from now on. Sorry, I can't have beans.
I don't want to lose my life.
Yes.
My breath of life.
Oh, that life is stinky, though.
Maybe that was the reason. He was
just
like, people.
Oh, can I not just put up with your farts? Can you just not eat beans? And then just made up a whole theory about it. Just so, like, people around him wouldn't eat beans. Because people must have been really nasty back in the day.
And there is the legend of the Day of Zeth regarding the story with his problems with beans. Is that one day he was followed by an angry mob and he couldn't escape them because he refused to go through a bean field. So he was
murdered.
Oh,
so he doesn't even want to touch them.
Right. He was absolutely repulsed by touching beans, the plant.
So he was killed?
Yes, he was murdered. He was bludgeoned to death.
Oh my God. But like, it doesn't make sense because by touching them, it doesn't give you flatulence. But then again, nothing else made sense, so it just adds to it.
So this was Pythagoras.
See, it's like he had this crazy brain for math, but then he had some shitty ideas about, like, how can a logical person that comes up with some theories that can explain math, right? And then have, on the other side, have this, really weird ideas about beans.
There's different types of sciences. Like, they didn't have any, well, not necessarily any, but they didn't have botany to explain. Because I think Aristotle came up with the classification of certain species,
mm-hmm.
where he took every type of plant that he could find, and he sort of made these parameters in which he would classify them. And he was Aristotle was much later
mm-hmm.
than Pythagoras. So maybe he had an issue when he was little with beans, and he wasn't able. And you're also talking about, because you do read about wonderful evolution in math and science at the time, and philosophy, mm-hmm. obviously. But you're also talking about, like, at the time in Greece, they still worshipped in some way the Greek gods.
Mm.
So you're not talking about atheism.
Yeah.
People still had beliefs.
Yeah. Maybe it's just wrong on my side to compare the way we think about beans now and how much we know about beans. Just to take the bean subject. I can't get over it. Compare that, how I react to this, to how back in the day, you know, as you said, they weren't as, like, scientifically as forward.
I like to think that it was an irrational fear.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if there was a field of beans, I doubt most people had a fear of beans. I think it was just his problem.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so my next guy is this one guy that I actually really, really like.
Mm.
He was kind of weird, but I really like him. Okay, so my next guy is Empedocles.
Mm. Sounds fancy.
Also pre-Socratic. He had a very, let's say, romantic view of understanding the world and explaining it to others. Empedocles sort of respected the same rules that Pythagoreans did. He was a vegetarian, he believed in reincarnation, he believed that all living things were on the same spiritual plane, that the plants, animals, and humans represented links in the same chain, which is interesting.
So how come he would still eat plants?
Well, shit, he had to eat something. Come on.
Mm-hmm.
What, did you wanted him to just sit and look at the sky?
No, but then you can't say that, oh yeah, plants are on the same level as me, but let me just commit murder.
No, I think the point he was trying to make is he didn't necessarily believe that the human is that much superior.
Yeah.
You know,
I'm with him.
I know, right?
He's, I like, cool. Him.
He is considered to be the first pluralist in Greek philosophy, which means that he was also a poet, a medical doctor, a preacher, a mystic, a magician, a prophet.
A wizard, a vampire, yeah.
Right.
All of the above. You just named all the big blockbuster films.
Yes. I tried to find more on him being a magician. So I was very confused. Like, he was just making tricks, like magical tricks. He was pulling out the bunny out of a top hat. I did find, however, his mysticism beliefs, which it was more cosmology.
Mm-hmm.
Today, he's actually most remembered for being the man who discovered... That kind of sounds stupid. I should rephrase it. He discovered air. It's not what he discovered. He named
the
it
chemical.
As a no, because they didn't have the notion of chemicals back then.
Mm.
But he's the first one who named air as a separate substance. Because if you think of it, you don't necessarily see it.
No, yeah.
So how would you come up? Because they had the elements,
mm-hmm.
water, fire. You see these things, but air is just something that exists in a way that, you know, you're not even...
You're not aware of its presence.
Right. You're not aware even of breathing sometimes.
Yeah.
Which is very interesting that he came up with the concept that, hey, you know, there's a fourth element, which mm-hmm. is air. So that's what he did. He named the four elements, water, fire, earth, and air. And he had this theory that all these elements were influenced by two forces.
Mm-hmm.
And those forces were love and strife.
Mm, I like him.
Strife or hatred. So love would sort of bring the elements together and create objects.
Mm-hmm.
Like how in pottery, you would mix water and earth, and then you would to mold it, and then you would bake it with fire, and then you would let it cool in air.
Yeah, so each component had its
right,
role.
because they were elements of which everything was created, even people to a certain degree. You know, blood, they would see it as a liquid, so it was mm-hmm. water. I'm pretty sure even metal, you know, because you melt it to yeah. make weapons and
yeah.
everything. So metal was considered a liquid, so water. So all these things would be brought together by love.
Yeah.
So if love would bring the elements together, then strife was responsible for keeping them apart. And these forces obviously would influence people as well. You know, love brings people together and strife keeps them apart.
Yeah, I like it. It's very simple and innocent. I don't know, it's very clear and straight to the point.
And sort of, I mentioned earlier that it was romantic, but...
Romantic, yeah.
I genuinely thought of it as very poetic.
Yeah.
Because he would have certain poems that he would write and he would dedicate his poems to the muses. You know, the Greek goddesses of poetic inspiration that they were deities of song, dance, memory, something else.
I feel like his way of explaining the world is how you would explain it to a child.
Yeah, that's a good point.
So it's like, oh yeah, we have all these elements and you have love and fire and love and hate, and then you can either make something or break something. It's right. Kind of cute.
It is. Yeah, it actually is cute. And it would work as a pretty good explanation for a very young child today. Like if you have a toddler, he asks all these weird questions and you don't want to get it into, you know, let me tell you how something is formed, where babies come from. It would be a very easy explanation. You know, we have love and we have hate.
Yeah, I like him, yeah. So far, he gets my points.
Okay, so now that you like him...
Oh no, don't ruin it. Please don't.
He was a little unusual. And for starters... he had a killer fashion sense.
Oh,
fashion
that's fine.
Style. Yeah.
That's fine. I thought he did something much more horrible.
No, he wasn't a dick. Well, not as far as I know. He was just weird. He did believe he was a god.
Oh, God. Okay.
Which I believe that sort of came from the same place where Pythagoras came up with his... ideas of, hey, I can explain all this shit with my numbers, so I must be a god.
Yeah.
So, okay, so let me tell you how this guy would dress day to day.
Oh, no.
He came up for money. He would wear a purple robe, a golden belt, and bronze shoes. And he would also have this weird thing on his head.
Mm-hmm.
So his point was that he actually wanted to attract attention.
Mm-hmm.
He was sort of an walking advertisement.
Oh, is it because like people would see him and then they would be like, hey, why are you dressed like this? And then he would start preaching.
Exactly.
Smart.
So, and he thought he was a god, but the good news was that you can also be a god.
Oh, God.
If you did whatever he preached. Well, it was sort of that whole love and strife thing. And you would have to obtain from certain things to reach the stature of God. Because I think he believed that every person was a god at one point. But due to...
reincarnation?
No, due to doing bad shit.
Oh.
They sort of... So the...
numbed down.
The cure for that was to do good shit. Because that's also the reincarnation thing. Because the idea of reincarnation... You don't want to be reincarnated.
Mm-hmm.
Because that would mean a cycle that can never be broken. You would live your lives over and over and over again. And the only way to break that cycle would be to live a life of thought and to withhold from certain things, like eating meat, for example.
Mm-hmm. Wouldn't it make more sense that if you didn't want to keep being reincarnated, to sin more? Or is it because, you sin more, because you live a life of sin, that you will get reincarnated, so you get to live another life and
yes,
do better?
Well, not necessarily, because okay. Yes, you do get a second chance, which is nice,
mm-hmm.
but I'm pretty sure you can only break that cycle by being human, which is not necessarily a guarantee that you will be human in your next life.
Oh, in your next life. Okay, yeah.
Because you have to do all these things, you know, you have to, like in Buddhism, you have to meditate and be very disciplined and to break that chain.
Mm-hmm. I mean, just dressing up like that is not that odd. Because I understand there's a scope behind why he dressed like that. Anything else that he did that was weird?
Well, the weirdest thing that he did was because he thought he was a god, which apparently wasn't that unusual at the time, in order to prove that he was a god, he jumped into Mount Etna, which at the time was an active volcano.
Yeah.
So he jumped into the volcano.
And he died?
Well, do you really think he was a god?
No.
Pretty sure he died.
No one found him?
He jumped into the volcano. Who would go to look for him?
I don't know. Maybe they could look down and see.
If he died.
Oh, wow. Why do they all have such weird deaths? Someone died because they didn't want to walk through a field of beans and they got beaten to death. Someone just jumped into a volcano to prove that they're God. What's the next guy going to do?
I'm also
find
very,
out.
Very, I'm very confused on what he was supposed to prove. Like, was he supposed to prove that he was immortal? That he wouldn't die because he jumped and he would live? How? Mm-hmm. Or what?
I think that was the point. Look at me, I'm going to jump and not die, and that will prove you that I'm God. So,
But in the scenario that he would have jumped and he wouldn't have died, what would happen?
People would believe him. No one jumps into a volcano and survives.
But he would still be in the volcano. Like, did the people that came up with him to the volcano when he jumped, did they wait for him to come back?
He probably said, witness me rise back. So he would, like, fly. He would just, like, the volcano would just push him back up. Because if he's God and if he's, like, in touch with nature, nature would support him back.
Well, that's kind of shitty, because if the volcano would just spit him out, wouldn't he hurt the people that weren't gods?
I don't think he thought of that much. He didn't think that much further.
He was, okay, so listen to me, guys. I'm going to jump. It's going to be fun.
You just watch.
Yeah.
Too bad there were no, like, phones so they can take pictures and...
Yeah, now you would find him on YouTube. Look at this fucking idiot jumping into a volcano.
How old were they both when they died? Were they pretty old?
I think so. I think Pythagoras was older. Like, he was at a senior age. I don't know. I sort of think that he knew he would die.
Yeah. So he's like, might as well go out and on my terms.
Yeah, because maybe... He knew he would die, so he sort of, you know, go out in a blaze of glory.
Yeah.
To live the people that would witness it with sort of this impression.
I mean, I liked him initially, and then he kind of went bonkers the other way, so I don't know. I like the things that he lived by, with the main thing being that animals and humans and plants were all on the same level and the romantic way of viewing the world. I like that.
I'm glad.
Now, what's the third one?
Okay, so this disgusting fucker. My third guy is Diogenes. He's also referred as Diogenes the Cynic. He was one of the founders of Cynic philosophy, which didn't, well, Cynic at the time didn't necessarily mean what it means today. It meant to live a Cynic life, meant to live in agreement with nature, sort of what the other guys preached, but not as, well, you'll see.
Go on.
So he was one of the founders of the Cynic philosophy, but he took it and he put it on steroids.
Oh no.
he was exiled, I think in his youth, maybe, well, he wasn't that old, but he was exiled from Sinope, and people believed and report that that was the main driving force of his belief.
Mm-hmm.
So because he had to live in exile, he was poor, he was homeless, and he decided to live his life in disregard of luxury, but also in disregard of laws and customs that could be considered conventional.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, for him, that was the way to achieve true freedom.
Right.
Sort of like the hippie. You could say that Diogenes was the original hippie. Flower power and peace, man. Because I think you can, it's actually a fad today to live self-sufficiently, to build those tiny homes yourselves.
Yeah.
You know, the ones in old school buses.
And, yeah, yeah.
And also secondhand shopping is very, very popular today. So maybe you can say he was revolutionary.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what was the problem with this guy? Well, he was a bum. He lived years of his life wandering from city to city. He was very dirty and repulsive. Not necessarily because he was a bum, but he did everything in public. He did his business in public.
Oh no.
That meaning that he urinated in public, and the other thing in public, and the other thing in public. He sometimes walked backwards to confuse people.
Yeah, makes sense. Throw right. them off a bit.
They were like, oh, what the fuck? What is this glitch?
In the Matrix.
Right. He would constantly challenge norms and conventions.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the main reason why people hated him.
Mm-hmm.
Not because he was in disagreement with everything, but I think it was mostly because he was dirty and disgusting.
Mm-hmm.
And people started calling him a dog, which the name Cynic, the word Cynic, comes from the Greek word for dog.
Ah.
He is depicted in many works of art as living in a wine barrel. He was a beggar, and he would practice begging in front of statues.
Okay.
So that he wouldn't be disappointed when someone would refuse him.
So remind me again, why is he great? Why is he one of the great philosophers?
He came up with this philosophy because he started a movement, for lack of a better term.
Mm-hmm.
There were many people that lived like him after he popularized it.
She's more of a... Because I don't know, philosophers, I feel like they throw out an idea and a way of thinking, but not a lot of people, at least nowadays, I don't know, maybe from my perspective and the environment I live in, it's like they throw an idea, I read about it, and I'm like, cool. But like, I don't know if people actually adopt it and live through that. Do you know what I mean?
Well, to be fair...
Because for him, it's more of a movement, like the actions he's actually doing, rather than thought and a way of thinking. I mean, it is a way of thinking.
It you're sure is.
Thinking and it, to do and it that. Is,
considering the things I said before with people living self-sufficiently and in tiny homes and secondhand shopping and sort of opposing capitalism.
Yeah.
I would say that out of the three guys I talked about, he is one of the most...
out there?
No, the his ideas can be and are applied today.
Today, yeah.
Not necessarily to the extent that he did.
Mm-hmm.
Well, sort of in the 70s, the hippie movement was pretty much the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't want to live in the conventions of the state I'm in. I don't abide by any laws. I don't agree with your social rules. Mm-hmm. So I will live free in my way.
Okay, I see it.
He had this, which I think it's important, this question everything
mm-hmm.
mentality.
Trust no one.
Right. Mm-hmm. Why do we do a certain thing a certain way? Why do we hold jobs? Why do we live in homes? Well, there are obvious reasons to it.
I like my comfort.
Yeah.
Kind of like detaching.
Maybe that was his point. Maybe you weren't supposed to be too comfortable. Because
mm-hmm.
you wouldn't be free if you would live in... Because your happiness would be dictated by whether you are comfortable or not.
Yeah, yeah. I'm much happier when I'm home than when I'm at work. Because I'm not uncomfortable.
See, if you didn't have a home and you didn't have work you would I wouldn't have to worry about better.
It. Yeah.
Right.
I agree. I'm going to quit tomorrow.
He was a pretty interesting guy. The only thing that I doubt people can agree with is the whole hygiene problem.
I mean...
And sort of peeing and masturbating in public.
Nay. Okay, now question, how did he die?
Oh, I don't know how he died. Maybe he just got the plague or some shit.
Yeah, maybe he just died from like a toe infection.
Right.
That just spread all over.
I do have one thing that I found very cute, sort of a legend that says that one day Alexander the Great offered Diogenes everything he wanted. And all he had to do was name it. Diogenes, I will give you whatever you want. You just say it in order to sort of prove his point that, dude, you can't live like this.
Yeah.
You gotta want something.
You have something that, yeah, you want.
Right. And I am Alexander the Great, and I can give you anything. Mm-hmm. And the answer that Diogenes gave was that all he wanted was to Alexander to get out of his sunshine.
Yeah, I mean, apart from all the shit things he did, that was cute.
Yeah.
And at that point, pretty cute. Knowing that Alexander the Great, he's just saying this to prove a point, he was probably smart enough to be like, I'm not going to satisfy him by saying anything, even though I want something, you know? Could have been a case of that as well. It's like the pettiness of not giving in to this person yeah. that I think is so great.
It was, and maybe it was petty on both of
both sides.
Okay, so one thing I always like to do is to look at the School of Athens
mm-hmm.
by Raphael. You know, the fresco
mm-hmm.
at Vatican City with those guys on the stairs and
mm-hmm.
it's a crowd. And I like to look at it and identify the guys I read about.
Yeah.
So if you look at the fresco, you can see Diogenes is right in the middle of the painting. And he's the guy that's slouching on the steps.
Mm, the one in blue.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's Diogenes.
Mm-hmm.
And Pythagoras is on the lower left, writing in something in his book.
Yeah.
And he's surrounded by a lot of guys that look there like they're trying to copy his homework.
Yeah. What about the third guy?
He's not in the fresco. Right.
Who are the two main guys in the middle?
That's Aristotle and Plato.
Mm.
And it's very interesting that the movements is sort of their body language. Plato is the old guy, the guy in red,
mm-hmm.
that he's pointing at the sky. And he was very interesting because that's sort of Plato's belief that all the answers can be found up there,
mm-hmm.
you know, sort of looking up. And Aristotle's belief is sort of holding his hand parallel to the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And he believed that all the answers that they were looking for would be found on earth.
On earth, yeah. That was very eye-opening. From beans to public exposure to jumping into a volcano. Very compelling stories. That's right. All I got from it. And love.
Well, to be fair, that's mostly what people know.
I didn't know those things. I just knew of the Pythagoras theory, and that's it.
Well, yeah, because we learned about him in a math environment. We didn't study him in philosophy that much.
Yeah. Which is stupid. What did we study in philosophy? Not this. Okay. So the first guy I picked was Nietzsche. He is a German philosopher, and he's mainly known for criticizing religion.
Right.
Like the traditional European morality and the religion. And they're conventional philosophical ideas. And he wanted to expose false consciousnesses that infected people's received ideas. Now, this is a lot of confusing words, right? To be exact, right?
Right.
He was infamous for constantly criticizing the traditional European morals and the foundation of, and what the foundation of Christianity was based upon, which meant that the religious faith, as well as many other aspects from what you would consider the base of morality.
Right.
So the base of your religious faith, as well as the base of what you consider as moral, they weren't like autonomous to yourself, to your one self. So he basically wanted to tell you that you can't really have a moral code without being influenced by a religious body. Like if you take
I get it. People are born inherently bad.
Kind
of. Or at least immoral.
Yes. So during that time when he came with this idea.
Oh, wait a second. So he wasn't an atheist? He was a theist? He believed in God?
No, he was an atheist.
Right.
A lot of European intellectuals at that time, they all believed that their moral code was individual from any religion. So they thought they weren't influenced by any religion to create their own moral code. But he was like, you're so naive and you don't even understand how much influenced you are, but you say you're not.
What do you mean exactly when you say moral code?
Where does your compassion come from? Where does the feeling of wrongdoing?
Right.
Like how can you tell that the notion you have of compassion is not from what religion told you it is?
Okay. So why? Why did he give that much credit to religion?
I don't know.
Because it sounds a little bit counterproductive. Because you're saying, I don't believe in a god.
He literally said, he launched the idea that God is dead. So he literally said, God is dead.
Yeah, but what does that mean?
When I was researching this, I came upon a bunch of confusing words that were linked to form a more confusing sentence. And then I had to read like a lot of times to understand. So he believed that our standard moral code and commitment lacked the foundation we thought we had. So we thought we had a foundation for our moral code when in actuality it wasn't there.
But what did we think our foundation was?
So the foundation was the Bible. This is when majority of people were very highly religious, right? In the 1800s. This is in the 1800s. So if you had to take that unquestionable authority of the Bible away, if you took that our morals would prove to have no actual ground base and to actually be harmful to us.
Our morals?
It's very confusing, I know. That's why I want to discuss this with you, because I don't really understand.
I'm genuinely confused, because I think it's very counterproductive to... I get it that he thought that people aren't born good. Like, it's not... You develop your moral compass. You're not born good. What it sounds like to me, he thought that people were born bad, immoral. You didn't have the same... You don't have empathy. You don't have idea of what right and wrong means. So I get that. But what I don't get is why would he give that much credit to
religion?
Right. As an atheist.
I think because it's a society aspect, religion is a very much society. Because another point he made was that if you compare two countries, like if you compare two continents, even two countries, there are slight or even big moral differences, right? Like, let's take the subject of eating meat, eating cow. You are okay with eating beef, right? But in another society, that is deemed as morally wrong.
Right.
Do you get it? So if you take those out, if you take the aspect, because eating beef in another country is considered immoral from religious points of views, right?
What country are we talking about?
Is it India that they don't eat beef?
I think that's it.
Yeah.
Right. So due to religious beliefs. Okay. Keep going.
That was it. That was just his theory that without the religious aspect, our morals would be maybe not even there.
No, that's not unusual. That's just the downer.
Yeah.
Because I get the point. Because it was used as a form of organizing masses, which you needed at the time.
Yeah, I agree. But he's kind of a nihilist, so he likes to make himself miserable. He just wanted to
suffer.
I think he was literally known as a nihilist, even though he wanted to counteract that, you know, reputation.
I think I got what he was about. I just didn't understand.
Like, he didn't really want to seek the truth. He didn't really want to seek the truth from what critics believe of him. He was just wanting to, in the end, when he got this reputation of a nihilist, so he wanted to be like, nah.
I will adopt all the puppies in the world.
No, he was like, oh no, I'm actually just embracing people to deconstruct their morals and reconstruct them in a better way. Kind of like that was what he was after.
Well, I get that. I'm just not sure how was I supposed to get from whatever he was saying to, you know, just start questioning my morals. Like, where do... And it's not... I think when I hear... Maybe I'm wrong, but when I hear morals, I think of something that's very universally believed as being wrong. So why would I start to question why my society condemns murder?
Okay, maybe not universally known things, but maybe more specific things. Like if you think women's rights, for example, in certain countries... You know, you might not question that aspect because you have rights. But maybe he was trying to reach someone else.
Does that qualify as moral? Maybe it would have helped to know what exactly he was referring to. Because it's very general.
General.
Because right. I went to the extreme, to the universal thing. I don't necessarily think it's helpful to... Well, not helpful, but... What would I get out of questioning why it's bad to hurt people? I do think, though I'm not sure if I'm applying it correctly in this situation, but I do think about the discourse of systemic racism, that it's sort of built in the system, and even internalized racism, when you don't even realize that you are racist or you have racist behaviors.
Like we've talked about people that we know from a country that's not as exposed to other races.
Right.
That would make a joke and not realize it's racist and just thinking, oh, it's just a joke. I didn't mean it in a harmful way. But then from this other perspective, it did come across as harmful, but they don't know that.
Yeah, and you do need...
So do they need to deconstruct their morals? And that's not okay what right. they're doing. But they think they're doing nothing wrong.
Yeah, and you do need sort of what he was preaching, which is introspection.
Yes.
Look inside yourself and find out why certain things are the way they are and change them.
Because I think a lot of people think that they're in the right, even though they do wrong things, like just taking this example of being racist. And it's complicated because you can't make them, it's difficult to make them understand that they're being wrong when in their eyes they are correct. You know, like, I'm not doing anything wrong. It was a harmless joke.
Right.
So how about just everyone do some self-inspection?
That's the moral. Maybe that's what, of the story.
Of the story, yeah.
Everybody needs a little introspection.
Yeah, that was Nietzsche. Now my next guy is David Hume, a Scotsman.
Oh.
So he grew up very religious during the Calvinist era in Scotland. And his parents kind of forced him to go into like the legal field, and he was like, nah, this is too boring. I'm gonna go to even more boring stuff, philosophy.
Hey, watch
I'm
it.
Joking. Then later on, he moved to France, where he, because he was so constrained during his childhood, he kind of like, when he moved, he was like, nah, I'm doing what I want. So he moved to France.
Oh, because he had a religious background, or?
Yeah, he was very, right. It was very strict when he was growing up. So he moved to France, and then he started offending people in France.
It's not that hard to
do. By criticizing religion again. Another guy that criticizes religion. He criticized his own religion that he was raised in and any other religion that was out there. And he tried to apply for a lot of like schooling positions so he could be a teacher. But because of his outspoken criticisms, no school was like, mm-mm, we don't want you here. We don't want you like brainwashing our kids. With your non-religious views.
With your reason.
Be careful there. So he then focused more on philosophy, and he kind of started focusing on the human nature and studying the human nature from kind of a scientific point of view. So what's the science behind the human nature?
Okay.
And he thought that by explaining the human nature scientifically, therefore we can explain all the other sciences that the human has invented, like math, politics, all the other sciences.
Don't they explain themselves? Or maybe he was just trying to find the...
How we got
yeah,
there.
How did we get there? All
yeah.
Right.
Yeah, like how could humans create that, maybe be capable of that.
Okay.
So he noticed that most philosophers before him would use hypotheticals. So he wanted more to observe and explain the human nature through from like experience.
Oh, okay.
From like, oh, I'm doing this, this happens.
So he was genuinely looking for a scientific method in philosophy.
Yeah, for literally like a scientific explanation.
Right.
He wanted to exclude any religious views and reasons why people would do that. Like, why people would consider murder, as you've said before. Why do people consider murder wrong from a non-religious point of view?
Right. So he wanted to find morality outside religion. Well, at least this guy is a little more uplifting. He believes there is morality outside religion.
Yeah. He's not questioning morality. He's just like, he just wants to understand how thought works.
Right.
He got a lot of inspiration from Newton, and that's why his approach was more practical, based on actual fact.
It's very interesting. Maybe he shouldn't have studied philosophy. Maybe he should have went into
actual science.
Right. It sounds like a very different approach.
Yeah. He basically just wanted facts and proof, like physical proof. he hoped to succeed in examining the mind, the way that Newton explained the power that governs the planets, and not by attributing this power to a supernatural source, but by actually finding
right
explanation through math and physics and all of that. But then again, if you think of it,
so would he use, wouldn't he use medicine?
Yeah, he's using all these sciences that the human, maybe it's kind of like a backward thing where you use the end to explain the beginning.
I get that, but I'm confused. I'm very confused about how was he going about it.
Well, I'm gonna tell you.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm not done.
I'll be patient.
It's okay. So he wanted to find the laws, literally like Newton, finding laws by which the human mind functions.
Right.
And he called these mind actions as perceptions, and how they combine and create even more complex perceptions, which are known as thought, belief, feeling, and action.
Okay.
Thought, belief, feeling, and action, these are all known as perception. That's how he called them.
I see.
Like kind of like a general...
Yeah, like an umbrella term.
Yes. And he thinks that all of these are connected and influenced by the experience we've had.
Oh, no shit.
Like all the experiences through life. So kind of like it's influenced by where you, how you, like where you grew, like all the these outside factors and all you've been through.
Oh, so it, maybe he was studying psychology. He didn't
kind
know it.
Kind of, because he gets into like terms, and which I'm not getting too detailed, but these ones are the ones that I actually found interesting. So, you know, like we talked about perceptions.
When did this guy live?
In the 1700s.
Oh, so he was way before psychology. Freud was born in 1856, so much later.
So Nietzsche was more of a Freudian boy.
I don't know what that means, and I doubt I want to. Did he like to talk about his mom?
Who, Nietzsche?
Don't answer.
Okay, back to him. So, perceptions, right?
Right, perceptions.
So they're divided, they divide into two. He divided them into two sections, which are impressions and ideas. Impressions are like sensations, desires, passions, and emotions.
Okay, it makes sense.
So those are impressions. And then ideas are the faint images of all of the above.
Oh.
Okay, let me give you an example. So the difference between the impressions and ideas, so it's the difference between the feeling of pain when you actually, when you stab your toe in right the corner of the sofa, that's an impression because right it's pain. You okay feel the pain, the sensation of pain. And then the idea is remembering.
Oh, it hurts.
Yeah.
I get it.
Do you get it? Yeah. And
So it was sort of, because the first category was how would you call them, reflexes?
It's about, yeah, and it's also about,
and then the second one is more
the idea of them.
Yeah,
the,
but that's thought, a very weird way. Yeah, the thought of it,
of that emotion.
Okay,
kind of like that. It gets much more complicated.
But does this it is, get weird?
I didn't actually go that far into researching these guys, but this is kind of the way in which he wanted to literally scientifically analyze the mind and human nature.
It's very interesting.
It's interesting. He literally wanted to explain the human, just like Newton explained the planets and the movements and that. But he kind of wanted to explain the thought that way, like how we think, maybe.
Right. I find it interesting because he does sound like he was looking for psychology.
Mm.
But in a little, like, there is method in psychology. You would apply certain procedures to have a certain outcome. But I'm more confused. Like, what exactly was he looking for? Because is it, because I'm not sure if it's medical. If it, he would actually want to watch two neurons.
No. I didn't think so. Sort of. It was more of the idea of thought and how do we get thoughts? Like, what's the mechanism behind that? Because it's not neurological, is it? I think that's what he wanted to find out. Because I'm like, do I get the thought of wanting to stab myself with the scissors from where? From wanting
you lost
to...
me.
No, but like, okay, so let's say the impulse. You know the impulse of... When you're, maybe you haven't lived it, but I know people that do. When they're on the edge of a building, they feel the impulse to jump.
Right.
Where is that coming from? Maybe that's what he wanted to explain.
I'm not entirely sure. It's not I want to jump. It's just vertigo, isn't it?
No, some people want to jump. Is it curiosity? Is it what? Not even getting to what the feeling is. It's like, why am I getting this feeling? Like, what's the mechanism in my brain? Mind. It's not a brain thing, it's a mind thing.
Okay, so he was looking for psychology then?
Yes, I think so.
He didn't have an interest, a medical interest
no,
in it.
No, he didn't mention any medical terms.
Right.
But he called it philosophy.
I get it, I think. Your guy was looking for psychology and he didn't even know it. But psychology is a much recent science. And that's what I find interesting, is that this guy was, what, 2 centuries apart before psychology was a thing? It's very interesting. The 20th century was a very interesting time period because I think due to 2 world wars, life moved very fast.
Yeah. Oh God, the last guy I've got is Danish and his name, I'm not going to pronounce his whole name, just one name. This one name I'm going to pronounce is Kierkegaard.
Okay, we got to find him a nickname.
No. Well, his first name is Zoran, so I think that could be easier.
Z, let's say Mr. Z.
It's an S, actually.
S, Mr. S.
Mm-mm. It's fine, I can say Kierkegaard.
Yeah, but I can't.
You don't have to, just say this Danish guy.
Okay, this Danish guy.
So he's like on the opposite spectrum from Nietzsche and Hume. He's quite...
Oh, thank God.
He's quite religious.
Oh.
Yes.
Never mind. Well, he... Literally, thank God.
He had a lot of philosophies, but I focused on this just as a contrast from the other two guys. And I'm also finding people's philosophies about religion interesting. So he also had some psychology and fiction involved in his works, which I'm not going to get into, but just as a background.
He reminds me of someone.
Yeah, same. So he wanted to renew the faith of Christians, and he's known as the father of existentialism.
Okay, right. So he was constantly asking himself, why am I here? Did God put me here? And for what purpose?
Yeah, he's also known for rebranding all the biblical figures to kind of match the modern times. So he kind of tried to make them even more relevant to the public. But not really, because we'll get there.
Okay.
He said he wanted to, but then his philosophy is like, all right, guy. He was not a traveled philosopher. He was just chill in his flat in Copenhagen. He did travel a bit, but he was just mainly, if anything, he would go and start up conversations with strangers on the street when he would just walk. So his personal life, because of his father and fiance, his personal life affected his work quite a bit. Like, it would come through his work. He wanted the previous philosophers to be, I think he wanted them to be seen not separate from his work, from their work, because a lot of times he said that philosophers would preach the complete opposite of what their life actually looks like.
Oh.
So he was like, don't separate the two.
I don't know if I agree with that.
No, because I'm like, do what the preacher says, not what the preacher does. It's like a very well-known...
And it's also, you are allowed to come up with good ideas and not respect them.
Yeah, apply them to your life.
But that's based on human nature, which is fine, I guess, in a way.
It's kind of hypocritical. Yeah.
It is.
I mean, if you're aware that you're hypocritical, then okay, but that doesn't really hold your case much. You know, like if you're trying to preach me something that you're not even applying to yourself, how do you expect me to follow you and apply that if you yourself are not? It just sounds like diegetics. Anyways.
You want to give that another take?
No. It's fine if people don't understand what I'm saying and referring to. Okay, so going back to his religious point, he mainly wanted to prove to people. So he didn't want to make religion easy for people to understand. He didn't want to make it as accessible. I don't know if that's the right word. He basically just wanted to make people realize that the distance between the frail humans is very immense to God. So God is unreachable. That's how big of a deity he is.
Oh, brother.
That God is the only one that could save your life.
Okay.
So he wanted to make people realize that by the simple fact of just thinking about how people can sin and that God doesn't sin and he's the only one that could forgive people's sins and wash them off of their sins. And he wanted to make people realize that through this fact that he's the only one able to make us without sin and good, to make us realize that he's that good. That he's that big of a... He's God, but like... Yeah, you say, yeah, God. But he kind of wanted to make people understand that it's much more than that.
But how is this philosophy? It sounds like a very intense preacher.
He was very religious. I think maybe he used methods of philosophy to explain this type of religious thing.
Oh God. You have anything else? This guy sounds very boring.
He thought about the notions of good and evil. And okay. That, again, going back to morals, that was a big thing with philosophers, wasn't it? Let's take the case of murder. Only God can say if that murder was good or evil. So our socially accepted morals don't really matter if God decides something else, basically.
Huh? Then how the fuck do I know I'm doing the right thing? He just told me, oh, it doesn't matter. You have your morals, but, well, you might be wrong, you dick.
Yeah, there was an example I didn't really get into. Maybe you know anything about Abraham?
I remember, this was fucking bullshit. God gave him a son, right? And then God was like, well, you know that son that I gave you? It would be a shame if something would happen to him. So he makes Abraham, he asks him to take him to whatever place where he has to sacrifice Isaac, his son. And it would be sort of, this is how you prove your loyalty and belief in me.
So through this Abraham story,
right?
Because God makes him basically murder his son, right?
Well, I don't think he does murder him. Wait, give me a second.
He doesn't.
He doesn't kill his son. He was really ready to fucking murder that kid, but he didn't do it because the angel came and said, yo, homie, we were just kidding.
Through the Abraham story.
Right.
Kierkegaard.
That guy.
He basically wants to prove that would, socially, it would be considered very immoral, right? To kill your own son.
Right.
But because God asked you to, then any social norms are thrown out of the window.
I see.
Even though he didn't in the end, it was just a test. Oh my God, why does God sound like a girlfriend? Like a psychotic, possessive girlfriend in this thing? Why? Do you understand?
I think so, but I hate it.
Yeah. And again, it's like, oh, have you got morals? Well, chuck them out the window because they don't matter in this philosophy.
If God doesn't feel like they matter today, then they don't.
So it was funny because he's like being religious. So he's trying to convince me to believe what he believes. Yeah. But then he's proving the same point as Nietzsche. And
yeah, nothing matters.
And he literally said God is dead. So I'm like, what are you trying to prove?
Well,
I personally just find these theories interesting to read about. And the only thing I can think of is people had so much time on their hands to just read and study and come up with these ideas that I could never. How do you not get mentally exhausted? Nietzsche kind of, he got really bad in the end.
Oh, well, then that's your answer. That's why he had such a hard time. He had issues.
Yeah, but what about these other two guys?
The Danish guy seemed like he had a blast. He was like, well, fuck, nothing matters. God decides.
Basically, yeah. I just like reading about it. Because I'm like, yeah. They just lived in a completely different reality. Just the fact that every day I just realize it hits me and I look at people on the street. It's kind of like usually you don't care. You're like, yeah, I'm living my life and these are just items moving around me, right? But then you just look at them and it's like everyone has their own life and everyone has their own reality and they think their reality is the correct one. Everyone. Do you know what I mean? Sometimes I think that and I'm like, no, that's a bit too much thinking for me today. Just take a break.
I think I do, though I don't agree with the concept of, oh, they have a different reality. They do have their own lives.
Yeah.
And I think that's what trips me out sometimes as well.
Yeah.
Because I look at people and I realize like that, oh, I had to eat my breakfast and brush my teeth and have 3 mental breakdowns today.
Oh, no.
They probably had to do something similar. Which is very interesting. It's interesting because you experience life just from your own point of view.
Yeah.
And you can absolutely use empathy to understand other people. But your understanding can only go
so far.
So far.
Yeah, because I'm like, I have all these issues that I deal with in my life. And then I'm thinking, everyone has issues. So then I'm like, at that point, I just start panicking. And I'm like, I don't want to deal with everyone else's issues. Why am I thinking about this? That's why I would never be a philosopher. So go insane.
Really, I think I personally find it quite humbling. It puts things in perspective.
It does, but at the same time, it's not solving my issues.
Well, no, but...
It's the it could be worse thing.
I know. I find comfort to know that I'm not alone in my pain. That other people experience it as well.
Yeah, I agree with that. Like, let's say that there was just one person that in the world that was blind. Kind of like that.
Right.
Yeah, it's just sometimes it's a lot.
I do find it sort of scary to be too long with my own thoughts.
Yes, that's why we have TikTok. Yeah, I don't like being alone with my own thoughts for more than 5 minutes. It's a long time. A long time. I just don't do it.
It's interesting, though, because it's not just... A big part of it is observing. You have to look at the world outside of you to come up with the answers to certain questions that you might ask yourself. So I don't think it's just, oh, I sit in my office with the doors and the windows closed and I just think about, why am I here?
Obviously,
what is my purpose?
Obviously, you have to read other people's experiences and thoughts to come up with your own.
I think I would like it.
To be a philosopher?
Yes, but because I do like the study part of it, the research, reading about what people, you know, sort of how do they come up with all this ideas.
Yeah,
even
I like
if you
that.
Don't agree with any of them.
That's why I just love reading about like all the different views about this well-known worldwide subject of religion is everywhere. I just love knowing what other people think about it and their philosophies on it. Because even though, let's say, there's a lot of people being that are Christian, every interpretation of that could be different depending on who you're asking.
Yeah, I agree.
I've really actually enjoyed doing the study for this.
Oh, I'm glad. I like it a lot. Maybe we can also mention that this is a very broad subject.
Yes.
And we discussed six guys, and maybe we can come back to the subject one day to talk about some other guys. Because also the term weird is very subjective. They were unusual based on
the norms back then.
That too, but also what we personally thought meant unusual.
Yeah, it's very subjective.
So maybe the listeners can suggest some other guys we can discuss. Okay, thank you. Bye.